Hello, and welcome to another edition of ECLECTICIST. ECLECTICIST is an investigation of everything from a British perspective by two brothers who consider themselves to be relatively normal chaps. Generally speaking, we are lay people, but occasionally some topics may stray into arenas of expertise. We are me, Benjamin De Campos, a designer and believer.
Jeffrey Campos, a devil's advocate and engineer.
We choose a topic of interest, spend a little time researching it, have a discussion, this podcast, and publish the notes. The main benefits of doing this is to understand the world a little better and to prompt further thought and discussion from our listeners. The topic we'll be discussing this edition is car design. When the automobile became a commodity, manufacturers felt pressure to not only improve function, but to improve appearance. There are a number of contributing factors in determining a car's aesthetics. The style of the age and technological advances are just two obvious examples. Even with that in mind, manufacturers appear to burn a lot of energy creating generations of cars which bear as little, superficial, resemblance as possible to their predecessors. So much so that any car plucked out of the automotive timeline is essentially a snapshot of the zeitgeist. Why is this necessary? And despite the steep ramp in change over time across the board, why does it appear that so many manufacturers collectively churn out the same car? Laziness, or perhaps cars are now fully evolved? Who knows? There was a time when cars didn't all look the same. For example, in the 1970s, a Citroen looked like a spaceship, a Mercedes a breezeblock, a Jag E-type a phallus. These days, if you gaffa tape over the badge, it could be anything.
But when we talk about car design, what is it we are actually talking about? Now, you mentioned in the introduction there that automobiles became a commodity. That is to say, they were selling in enough of a quantity and with enough competition that the manufacturers started thinking about the aesthetic appeal and the general design.
Mm.
Why might that have happened? And how profound was that change? I mean, it seems to me that perhaps that was always in the mind of the manufacturers, but I guess they really were focused on just the transport aspect.
Well, according to Wikipedia, it seemed like in the 1920s or 1930s was when manufacturers started to put a little bit of style into their creations. It wasn't all about function. As I say, it was a commodity, so you know, it was... car manufacturers were competing with each other, and so they had to think of ways to get people to buy their cars. So it wasn't just enough that their cars got them from A to B. And it seemed like by the 1920s or 1930s or whatever, the car had been around for quite a while. So it had been a functional thing, probably owned by not many people, until the point where more and more people could actually own a car themselves.
So perhaps this is just the effect of competition. This is just the way it is. I mean, you're going to want to make your product more attractive to whomever buys your product if there's competition. Well, if there's no competition, like, let me think, Microsoft, during their heyday, there's no competition at all. Therefore, their product was as ugly as they cared to make it.
I think so. And if you look at, I mean, to take that as an analogy, I mean, I think a lot of operating systems are looking a lot more attractive. There's more of an eye for, or there's more attention to detail, I should say, in terms of all the little bits, which I think Apple has made great strides in bringing everyone's attention to that. But yeah, I think you could draw an analogy with that.
So it's competition that drives the development of perhaps functionally unnecessary aspects of products. So in with cars, the manufacturers wanted to effectively make the cars attractive to their buyers. So when we say attractive, what do we mean? When we say car design, I always think that we're talking about ergonomics and we're talking about what makes the entire car as an experience better. So not any one thing in particular, but it's just the entirety of a car, you know, automobile, the experience. So it's not just the look, it's not just the way it works, it's everything. All together, the entire experience of driving a car. How do you see car design originating? I mean, how did it start, basically? I mean, I always think about the Model T Ford when I think about the first cars.
Mm.
So, I mean, you know, looking at that car, there's style was part of the original design. It was initially there. I mean, you know, it is designed with some thought, not just functionally getting people to A and B. There's, you know, it has a look, but of course that look developed along with technology as well. So we'll put whether or not technology is a driver or follows conceptual design of automobiles. We'll put that on the back burner for now. We'll talk about that later. But to start off, what is in the minds of the designers when they're moving away from a horseless carriage and trying to push into the future and with an increasing amount of competition?
Well, I mean, as I said in the intro, I think there's a lot of reasons for why cars look the way they do and why the designers make the decisions that they do. I think they are a snapshot in time. They are a product of their time visually. Also that the technology as well, you know, became popular in car design to have smooth edges and rounded flanks and all the rest of it, because we realized that cars can cut through the air better if they're designed more roundedly. And so that became popular. Cars started to have rounder corners and rounder edges.
Which I suppose, again, is another effect of competition, because if you want to build a car that can outperform your competitors' products, you're going to want to make it smoother and more aerodynamic, and therefore that will drive your design considerations.
Mm.
Again, it's competition that's driving change. And the change moves towards the goal of whatever the parameters are that excites the buyers. So I think where I'm going with all of this is, in your introduction, you say that, you know, you can tape on a badge of any manufacturer on a modern car.
That's certainly the case now.
And you wouldn't be able to tell the difference readily. I was on the road the other day and I saw three cars that looked strikingly similar. Mm. They were from different manufacturers. They're all
BMW,
German.
BMW, Audi.
Yes, yeah. They're all German manufacturers. It was an Audi, maybe A6. It was a four-door coupe, very sporty looking. And then there was a BMW four-door M6 coupe.
No.
Yeah.
It's, oh, no, it's coupe. Four, yeah, maybe.
Grand coupe, I believe it's called. Brand new car. Four doors, very sporty. And then there was the Mercedes XYZ class. I don't know what it is, but again, four doors, very sporty, you know, probably all the same sort of price point.
Mm.
So they contain probably similar technologies and probably source a lot of their components from the same supply chain, potentially. And I'm thinking that if all of the requirements of the marketplace are the same for every manufacturer, is it not inevitable that they will all start looking the same and performing the same and effectively do the same product?
Well, I mean, again, in the intro, I did say, have cars finally completely evolved? Is it the point now where they will all look the same because they've reached that perfect point?
Well, the changes are so trivial.
Yes. I mean, I don't think that's true. Also, do we really need all these different car manufacturers making the same car? That was the other point I was getting at. In that it's like you've got the choice there, you know, the Audi, the Mercedes, the BMW, whatever. Why can't we just have just one? Why do we need these manufacturers putting all their efforts towards making the same car?
Well, I mean, that's an argument against capitalism in general. I think you have lots of people working on separate projects trying to achieve the same goal, so you have a lot of wasted time in research and development. One person will invent the wheel and not tell anybody about it, forcing another group of people to do the same thing when they could have been collaborating and pushing the envelope farther. But again, the counter argument is that without competition, you're not going to drive innovation.
Yeah.
And if innovation stagnates, then arguably, looking at how design moves along with technology, design itself may stagnate.
Well, I mean, I think technology, you know, unless things go really pear-shaped, technology will be constantly improving. I don't think we need to worry about that. but it's the design. I mentioned earlier about how those, in fact, those three brands there, and they are brands, the Mercedes, BMW, and Audi, there was a time when they did make cars that were different from each other. The Mercedes had the big, huge chrome grille, big blocky thing.
BMW had the nostrils.
Yeah, BMW had the nostrils, but it wasn't just that. Their cars had very distinct characters to them. Same with Audi as well. Audi was kind of like almost the underdog, I think, in those days. And I think we've lost something in the fact that all cars are now just in the same pot.
Is that true? Because if you look on any high street in any town today, you will see gigantic 4x4s. Mm-hmm. You'll see very small, I mean absolutely microscopically tiny two-door smart cars.
Mm.
You'll see estates, saloon cars, every possible conceivable shape and size. Lots of different sizes.
Mm.
Obviously, there's a lot more choice now than there has ever been.
Mm-hmm.
Now, your argument could well be there's more choice of very generic, similar-looking machines.
That is my argument.
But there are also, you know, the spectrum is larger.
Mm.
You can get radically different-looking beasts. You can get a, you know, if you want a two-door car, you can get that, I believe it's a Nissan Juke.
Oh, yes.
Very distinctive-looking, chickeny-looking car.
Yes.
Versus another two-door car, which is a smart car, which I think is Mercedes.
Mercedes and Swatch, I think.
Now, they are both two-door cars that are designed to transport two humans from A to B, but they are fairly different looking. I mean, they don't look anything like each other at all. So my point is that they're the same. They're arguably the same class of car in terms of function,
right.
And yet they are radically differently designed.
Yes.
But they're serving the same function.
Yes.
So that's a large, that, you know, there's more diversity now is my argument. So to say that everything's generic looking, but distinct product categories have been created over the evolution of car manufacturing.
Yes.
So you have a specific car that's targeted at a small portion of the market, and all the manufacturers will build that car with trivial differences.
Yes.
Because they all have perhaps a tacit agreement to build a particular class of car. And this is focused by governments who want to have a ready classification system in order to apply taxation rules and you know, lots of conventions. So manufacturers are kind of cudgeled into producing a set number of product categories. So it's in, you know, everything is pushing the cars to look the same. It's not necessarily a design issue.
Right.
It's politics and economics and the realities of manufacturing.
Well, I think, yeah, I mean, that's probably true. But cars really are looking the same. And I think we can talk about some of the specifics of that. Contemporary design, if we talk about that. In particular, modern cars, I think, they all sport some interesting similarities.
When you say, just to put some signposts in the date ranges we're talking about here.
Okay.
When you say modern cars, do you mean like this year's models, or are you saying the last 10 years? Or
okay, by modern cars, this point to 10 years ago.
So remember, modern art is over 100 years old.
Right, okay. Okay, what I'm saying is a general trend on cars on the high street today. If you stand on the high road, in the middle of the road, and you look at the cars going by, the first thing one might notice if you're from another planet, you might say, oh my God, they all seem to be gunmetal gray or various shades of gray.
Monochrome.
Yeah, they're silver.
Color has been washed away from the concourse.
Yeah, these cars are silver. Lots of miles of black and silver. The black is the very thick pillars. The glass seems to be quite a lot of bits you can't actually see out of.
Framed with black.
Yeah, framed with black. And the actual part you see out of is quite small. So tiny windows is quite a popular style in contemporary car design. bulbousness is on the list here. I think that's true. You've got bumpers that are the bumpers, which are the plastic parts of the car, are generally huge, which is fine. It's all about safety. Huge wheels. We generally have massive cartwheels now in cars with very very spindly spokes, where you can see the disc rotors and various guts of the car. Low profile tires, which is essentially like a black line around this giant gunmetal disc, which is fine because we know that there's a reason why tires are so low profile these days. Don't we?
Rubber costs.
We spoke about that. Rubber costs and also
handling and lateral forces.
But also, I think that's less of a priority with people who generally buy a car to drive around the city. I think what would more concern them is the fact that these huge wheels are very easy to curb, and so many of these wheels that I see anyway on these modern cars are totally scarred by the curbs, which you didn't have in the olden days when you had these gorgeous big tires with the massive sidewalls. Tiny windows.
Which are basically Pontefract cakes with pins in the middle.
Yes, which I like. And the tiny windows thing, which is a bit of a bugbear with me. Now, I think the tiny windows thing is some strange virus that the car manufacturers have.
Glass costs.
Well, you see, the tiny windows are also combined with something called a high belt line, which is exactly what it says. It's like there's a lot more car before you get to the glass, which is fine. But having an experience of driving these cars, I noticed that they're hard to drive because, unsurprisingly, they're hard to see out of.
It's like a World War I tank.
Yes, but I think I can imagine an argument put to me would be, oh well, they've got sensors these days, so you don't have to worry about that so much. Not every car does. It's like, for example, my own personal car is a car from the late 60s. It was designed in the late 60s. It's a BMW E9, and we have a photograph of it in the show notes.
Yes, I must just say, a nice white one. We've got a lot of visuals in this edition, so it's probably a good idea, if you aren't already, listening along to the notes, which you'll find on the link on the website. Right at the bottom of our notes, we have lots and lots and lots of examples of the sorts of car designs that we'll be talking about.
So, listener, if you scroll down to the photograph, the white BMW, the 2800 CS, there's a lot of glass there. And as an owner of a car of that shape, they're very easy to see out of. You can see each corner of the car, which for me makes a relatively large car easy to drive. Whereas I drive our father's Honda Jazz, which is a late model Honda, very typical of your average kind of hatchback that you'd find in the high street today. And that's comparatively pretty damn hard to drive, because I look out of, I try and reverse, and I see very thick pillars, the B and the C pillars, and through the tiny windows, and it's difficult to maneuver and
rely on the sensors.
Yep, it doesn't have any sensors. That's the thing. And the BMW CS was designed, as I say, in 1967, I believe. And they got it right back then, as far as I'm concerned. They made a car, a big car, that doesn't feel like a big car because it's so easy to see out of. Now, what is the memo that I didn't get about why modern cars look the way they do, making them harder to drive?
Well, if I'm going to take my position as the devil's advocate here, and just as a point of contrast to that BMW, also in the images at the bottom of the notes, you might find the Jaguar sports car, which has an amazing hatchback rear window with the thickest possible black paint borders framing what little glass it has, and it's almost like a pointless vanity window.
It's like an iPad.
And even the rear view mirrors are slightly obscured by the body. It's absolutely incredible.
I mean, I might argue. Before you say anything else, though, that Jaguar does tick a lot of those boxes, because it is bulbous. It has a very high belt line. It has tiny windows, and has massive wheels. Which seems to be the blueprint that all manufacturers are using.
Okay, let me address a couple of these aspects of modern car design in terms of safety. Safety is incredibly important.
Yes.
Not only for the human baggage, but also for the insurance companies. Now, in order to tick all the boxes that the insurance companies would like to have ticked, the manufacturers really need to build a survival cage in between those wheels. They want to have airbags all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
They want to have crumple zones all over the place. And they want to have as little glass as possible, because glass is amazingly fragile stuff, and it really does cause lots of injuries. Mm. And you know, there's follow-on litter damage from glass as well. All round, glass is awful. I mean, it's just awful as a substance. I mean, you know, you break a glass and it's like, wow, lots of shards of glass. And if you consume shards of glass, it's incredibly bad for you. You can't see them on x-rays. They eviscerate you from the inside. Bad news. Glass is generally bad news.
Okay, now what
I'm going to have as little of it as possible in terms of safety is probably a better idea.
Now, what I'm going to say there is, for Christ's sakes, we can use something other than glass. We can have perspex, plastic, something like that. I would.
But you're talking about technologies that don't exist.
Well, I'll get on to that. But I would strongly contest that safety argument by saying, surely a safer car is one that you can see out of.
Yes, but you can look through sapphire crystal glass. But if you're moving along the road at 80 miles an hour and you're struck by another vehicle, you're going to wish you didn't have quite so much acreage of glass in front of you, I would wager.
Yes, but also I'd say that if glass really was the reason why cars had such tiny windows, then I think we'd do well to think of an alternative to glass, because we can. For example, going back to the BMW CS, the lightweight version, which is the more expensive one, that actually has a perspex rear screen, and that was back in 1972.
Well, perspex, again, from a safety aspect, it's not as rigid. It's harder to see through.
That's not true.
It scratches and tarnishes easier. Yeah, it is, absolutely. Glass, it has a much higher refraction index than glass does.
Well,
even laminated.
Yeah, but that's 1972, and I think in this day and age, you could definitely pull some resources
together. But
again,
you're talking about technologies that don't exist, so you could just say, why can't you have a force field around the car and completely get rid of all the glass?
No, I'm not talking about technology that don't exist. I mean, why do you say that?
Because you're saying, why couldn't they just make perspex windows instead of glass? Well, that's speculation. That's technological
speculation.
How do you know
that doesn't exist? I bet it does.
It might exist.
In planes,
but
for example.
It's your claim.
Now, I'm pretty sure that in modern fighter jets, the canopies are not glass. They're plastic.
I don't know what they are. I have no idea. But the glass in cars is getting stronger. They're making massive advances in glass technology. As we know from mobile phones and other industries. You know, you have Corning's Gorilla Glass, which is amazingly strong, absolutely incredibly strong. It blows my mind how strong it is.
Is this what iPhones are made out of?
No, iPhones don't use Gorilla Glass. That's why they shatter.
Right.
Other phone manufacturers who do use Gorilla Glass benefit from the incredible toughness of it. So no doubt, better quality glass is coming, and perhaps some kind of plastic or some kind of graphene may come along, which is as strong as the steel or whatever metal is used in the roll cage. And, you know, perhaps we'll move to a time when whatever vehicles we're driving will have bubbles, you know, canopies, cockpit-style bubbles, where you have 360 degrees unobscured visibility. But probably when that occurs, or when that possibility arrives, we'll probably have self-driving cars and sensors which remove us from the equation anyway.
Well, I think we could achieve that now, but I think car manufacturers are somehow tied to this trend of having small
windows. Well, I think that's exactly what it is. It's a trend. I think
that's why I said that.
I think you're exactly right. I think there are fashions, of course there are trends. It is design, it is style. So if a manufacturer strikes upon a particular design that catches on, they sell a lot. Well, then the designers won't be deaf to this. They will try to incorporate as much of it as they can into their own designs if they believe that they will yield greater sales margins from whatever it is. And I agree with you in that when we look at new cars of today, lower profile tires seem to be more popular. And perhaps the driver for that is the sort of people who buy performance cars, for instance, are inspired by motorsport and competition. Competition is always a driver. So perhaps when someone sees lower profile tires, they're seduced into thinking that it's a higher performance car, and that's linked onto the psychology of the status symbol of cars, perhaps. And maybe that's how it has come about.
But it's not just lower profile tires. It's also just the size of the wheels, really. It almost looks...
You mean relative size or actual size?
Both. It almost looks photoshopped, that Ferrari that you're looking at in the show notes, that red one, with the huge wheels. Now, I've put beneath that a photograph of my own Ferrari on there, which is a 1977 308 GTB. And you can see the genes there, can't you? You see the similarities.
Yes.
But obviously the 1977 car has got large sidewall tires, more glass, but it shares a lot of the DNA as you would imagine.
Is this not a look that's driven by technology and research and performance? I mean, in this particular example, a Ferrari is known to be a performance automobile.
Mm.
They're high performance machines.
Yes.
And through technology and research, the Ferrari, the modern Ferrari that I'm looking at in the show notes, the Ferrari La Ferrari, which is a amazingly vulgar name, it has a very, very low profile wheel. What we mean by that is, what I mean by that is that the rubber of the tire is just a tiny little rubber band wrapped around a very large wheel. So the size of the wheel has increased to fill in the space where the rubber of the tire was previously.
Mm.
Now, in terms of performance, you could argue that the less tire you have, the more stability you have, the more potential grip you have on the road, and the less lateral movement you have, so better handling and better power transfer from the drivetrain to the road. So with that in mind, the look is driven by the technology. And in terms, and when we come to Ferrari, perhaps performance pips fashion, maybe.
Well,
I don't necessarily believe that, but I mean, maybe they it was a compromise or a sacrifice to have the wheels that they do on modern Ferraris.
I'm not sure about using Ferrari as an example there, because the low profile wheel thing can just be explained. They are better for handling and the lateral movement and all that kind of thing. The other thing is, Ferrari might not be a good example for that argument because they are trendsetters. Ferrari, they're extremely expensive cars, and they have the best designers in the world, allegedly, who are designing, who are penning those cars. At least historically, that's always been the case. Of course, Enzo said, oh, you buy the engine and we throw the car in for free or whatever, but I think that's not true.
But can we ever know whether or not it was the designer who was responsible for the design of, say, the wheels?
Maybe
the engineers said to the designers, you can do anything you want, but you cannot touch the dimensions of these wheels because they're required for the power of the engine.
I think that's probably true, but I think, like all of these things, it's a compromise. I mean, you hear stories of... Well, not hear stories, but the original sketches from the design house or whoever who sketched these cars, the final car that's eventually produced, very rarely is it very similar. They've had to make so many compromises based on what can be achieved and also what the technology is.
Yeah, I think it's a reality check from the engineering department. They'll say, we really love your design and we like the direction that you're going in, but you cannot do X, Y, and Z because of restrictions and constraints. But we can do this, this, and this. And perhaps the engineers are actually recommending avenues of for the designers to travel down,
Actually, I'm just looking at that Ferrari there with the size of those wheels. This is the Ferrari Dino in the show notes.
The new one.
Yeah, I was just thinking, actually, there's a photograph I should add into the show notes, which is a modern BMW, and it's called the Z8. I don't know if you know the one.
The
Z8. Looks like, yeah, the Z8. It's It's a roadster, but it kind of owes a lot. In fact, you might have a photograph of the original.
Is this quite an old one?
It's about maybe 10 years old. No, 2000 it came out. But what's so remarkable about that car? I thought you had the old BMW in here. What's remarkable about it is it hardly changed at all from the original prototype to the actual version that they brought out, which is quite unheard of. But I would like to raise awareness about that car because it's one of the few modern sports cars that I think look gorgeous. But like the Ferrari Dino I just looked at and a few other cars like the Ford GT40 and the Lamborghini Miura, it's a kind of modern version, a kind of retro design that is a pastiche of some older design. So it's not entirely original. They're kind of using the heritage of a car as a kind of basis and making a modern version of it, which we should talk about.
No, we should. I think that's interesting. We've spoken before about design DNA and heritage and the family line and also taking inspiration from the past and how you might do that. So, for instance, you could build a car that is a copy of a car from history, and it's like an homage to that car. Or you could take the best elements and attributes of something that was successful in the past and incorporate it into a modern design, so more sort of a family lineage. And I think which design approach is more authentic? I kind of think just trying to build a modern car that looks similar to a car from history is lazy.
Yeah, but they know that they have a kind of market there. They're using the notoriety history of a successful design of the past and just rounding off the corners and putting huge wheels on it.
Exactly.
And then calling it something new.
Yeah, it's lazy.
But it is gorgeous, though. I do like that BMW Z8.
The Z8.
Yeah.
BMW are a funny manufacturer because I find their modern cars screamingly, atrociously, awfully horrible looking. I just think they look like they're sagging in the middle. There's a car from the bottom ranges that just the whole side of the car looks like it's sagging towards the ground, like it's melting. I think it's the BMW 1 series of some description.
No, I don't know.
It looks fairly awful. But of course, this is highly subjective.
Yes.
Really, I suppose you will always have the edges of the continuum where the most people will agree on the beauty or ugliness of a particular product.
Mm.
So, for instance, there are certain Ferraris that most people would agree are attractive.
Mm.
But in the middle, you have lots of cars where people, one person can find it absolutely fantastic, another person can think, I just don't see what you see.
Mm.
Just completely different, I don't get it. You can proselytize all you want, but I just won't come around to your way of thinking. We're genetically different. And for me, I certainly find most cars, generally speaking, they don't elicit any kind of emotional response from me at all. I
right.
just see them as machines, for my convenience,
mm.
and I just have issues with small ergonomic considerations,
yes.
like getting in and out of cars, which I find incredibly difficult or frustrating. I can do it,
mm.
but it's frustrating. I think they're very poorly designed. I think the way in which the doors hinge, they hinge where you don't,
yes.
Is ridiculous. It's awful.
Mm.
There's a new Rolls Royce where the doors hinge behind you. So when you open the door is effectively gone from your direction of egress.
This is a suicide
door. Suicide doors, right. That's what they're called. And I think they have a lot going for them. I don't understand why they're not more common. But I think I would speculate that one of the reasons why you don't see them much more commonly, or at all, is that there are certain rules that have come about over the evolution of car design that transgressors suffer from.
Hmm.
Examples would be three headlights.
One in the middle.
One in the middle. So the Tucker, for instance. Not a good look. People will look at that and they'll think there's something wrong there. I'm just speculating here. Another rule would be symmetry. all cars must be bilaterally symmetrical.
Mm.
To have an asymmetric car doesn't even bear thinking about it. Just, what are you talking about? It must be symmetrical. A face of a car, we're pattern-seeking animals. We see human faces in everything.
Yes.
Or we at least try to. And many, many cars, especially Japanese cars, will have a discernible face at the front of the automobile. And a face that is frowning or is similar to an expression that we don't find pleasing is a detriment to the car.
Mm.
An example of that, and I swear some manufacturers deliberately do this to their cars in order not to shoot themselves in the foot with their other models. Two examples I can think of are the Toyota, not the Aygo, but there's an even smaller one, IQ.
Oh, maybe, yeah.
Toyota IQ looks like it has developmental problems.
Right.
If you look at the front of it. And then there's the BMW 1 Series, I think the original 1 Series that came out. It looks as though they deliberately made the front of the car ugly. You could see that what it should have looked like, but they just thought, people are not going to buy our slightly more expensive car, and they'll buy this one instead.
Yeah.
So we'll make it a little less attractive because we don't want to hurt our own sales.
British Leyland was well known for nobbling lots of cars that were competing against their other cars.
Yes.
Going
back, infighting.
Yes, indeed. Going back to something that you said there. There are almost certainly lots of people like yourselves who don't give a damn about what cars look like necessarily. They're just interested in ergonomics and they're purely their function. But I think manufacturers, I think they take advantage of how a lot of people do see cars as status symbols, even though people won't want to admit that. But I think people do want to buy a car that will let others know certain things about you, like an extension of their personality or a marker in where that person might be in their life or how financially well off that person might be. And I think manufacturers, you know, make some real capital.
Well, yeah, they play on that anxiety, for sure. I think it's a very public possession. And not only the possession of a particular car is any great indicator in any particular way, but also it's the choice of car. That is to say, not necessarily the car that you can afford, but the type of car that you have purchased is, again, more insight and more of an indicator into the personality of the person who owns it. So I guess, again, I am a real believer in companies, manufacturers, and business sectors who have been around for a very long time are canny at cultivating their market. Car manufacturing has been around for 100 years, and they know a lot about their market. They know the buttons to push. They know how to push their cars. They will occasionally take risks. But generally speaking, given all the constraints, and that is how well they know the market, how predictable the market is, their competitors, the states in which they operate, and the constraints therein, I think a certain level of homogeneity is inevitable. I think that speaks to your original argument that cars are becoming a little bit generic, especially inside similar class of vehicles. Mm. And it's inevitable, and I think perhaps we should embrace it. As you said earlier, why have three manufacturers making a car that looks identical? Why not just have one car and one manufacturer in a sort of
those other two manufacturers can think of a way to make our lives a little bit better.
In another way. Why waste the brains?
You could indeed make an argument that is a sort of a communist way of thinking. It just seems like such an extraordinary waste of energy. There's so many of these manufacturers making the same car. But anyway.
But people have brand loyalty.
They do indeed.
So actually, they will get their brand's version of Car X.
Yes, but I mean, that's another thing about these cars, is they are a brand. And going back to Ferrari as well, in my experience of being around Ferrari people, a lot of them, they weren't that interested in necessarily the beauty of the car. And I would make a case that not many Ferraris these days really fall into the beauty camp. But that's a subjective thing. But they would more be interested in having a Ferrari because, again, going back to what I was saying about status symbol, what it said about them. So by buying a Ferrari, they're essentially buying their way into this lifestyle.
What is that life?
Well, yeah. If you say to most people Ferrari, what do they say? And you know, I think some people will recoil.
Successful, Lothario, witty raconteur.
No.
Discerning.
And I think there are
connoisseur.
There are also those people who sort of sneer and see and slap their foreheads even harder when it's a red Ferrari.
Oh, red Ferraris.
Yeah, exactly. That. Oh God. Midlife crisis, you know, this type of thing. Anyway.
Well, I'm a real one for the appreciation of the actual appreciation of the aesthetic, but also appreciation of the creativity that goes into the cars. So I think, you know, and also the community of contributors behind the manufacture of such a sophisticated machine. I mean, the cars these days are immensely sophisticated. Again, 100 years of supply chain development, all the various technologies, all the various new components, and the research that's been conducted.
They still break down.
They do break down, but I would wager, and I'm sure I'm right, at a much lower frequency than they did 10 years ago, 20 years ago, any amount of time previously. I was in traffic the other day, and it was, you know, thousands of cars per mile on the motorway. I mean, I don't really know how many cars you could fit into a mile, but, you know, bumper to bumper, the four-lane motorway was absolutely clogged, mile after mile after mile after mile. Cars have been sitting there idling and, you know, stop, start, stop, start, stop, start. A lot of stress on the engine. And yet there are no cars on the hard shoulder.
Right.
None. Unless they'd broken down and they were just being nudged forwards by the traffic itself.
Right.
But just the sheer number of cars and the fact that there wasn't even one on the hard shoulder just made me think, wow, you know, we're really moving into a level of reliability now that, you know, we couldn't have imagined 50, 60 years ago.
Possibly.
Really, really, these manufacturers really do know how to make a car. And it's not as though they're building a car as best as they could possibly build it with the best possible components and no expense spared. They also have the added pressure of making something that's cost effective. They're trying to compete on price with other manufacturers. So it's as cheap as they can possibly make it, and yet they're still phenomenally reliable. So it's an incredible dynamic of what you would imagine to be contradictory forces bringing about a machine that really can get you from A to B completely reliably, day after day, week after week, year after year, and you have a very small amount of worry there.
Mm.
It's incredible. I mean, there's an immense amount of respect that I'm sure you'll develop when you look into what exactly goes into the manufacturing of cars. And the design is just the icing on the cake. You know, I think that's the real hook that gets you to buy one of these cars. Because really, ultimately, a BMW, an Audi, a Toyota, a Honda, a Ford, they're going to get you from A to B. They're going to fulfill their function. So everything else is accoutrement, I think. And that's where design comes in these days.
Mm.
It's a nice to have, essential to have. And I think there's a wide variety of different car design now. I don't get the generic argument.
Really?
Again,
I thought you did
in class.
It sounded like you conceded that argument.
I'm not conceding it. I agree that because of all of the forces that we've discussed, there are product categories.
Mm.
And those product categories, they're going to look the same. If you have a four-door car that seats five people, that has a certain capacity of engine for tax purposes, and a certain, you know, design culmination of performance in the wind tunnel, you're going to get cars that look sort of similar. You know, they want to get their pollution down, they want to get their fuel efficiency up, and, you know, there are scientific rules that'll simply force you down a funnel of convention, and you will get something that just is similar looking.
Yeah, but again,
that's evolution.
There's my argument about why do we need so many of them then, if they're also if you can go to any manufacturer and essentially buy the same car in terms of reliability as the point I think you're
making. Well, perhaps a supply and demand. Perhaps one manufacturer simply can't produce enough cars to fulfill the demand. And you just need multiple manufacturers to actually produce all the cars that the 7 and 7.2 billion people on the planet are clamoring for. Maybe there just aren't enough cars to go around. It seems crazy given how long cars can last.
I think that's just manifestly untrue, just with the amount of cars there are clogging up the roads in our city.
It's true, but again, people want, you know, most people would want something that is reliable and is new and has all the latest, you know, technologies incorporated.
Yeah, but I mean,
it doesn't have a Bluetooth stereo.
I don't know if I agree with that, actually. I mean, I'm sure you know in lots of walks of life where people don't want change. They don't want to have to learn something new. So with cars seemingly having to, you know, constantly, I don't agree with this, but change their game, you know, each model that they bring out, that's kind of a bit unusual for us humans. We don't want change.
Yeah, but
we don't want to be confused all the time.
It's true, but you can't keep selling the same thing. You have to have differentiation. You have to keep bending those fenders.
Yes, just as, I mean, we should put in the show notes that famous quote by DeLorean, who said something along the lines of, he left General Motors because they were essentially churning out the same car, bringing out the same car, but just changing the fenders or whatever it was.
Because the idea, I think, especially in Western markets or any market where there's a fear of saturation and a fear of stagnation, you want people to repurchase. It's not enough to purchase. You want people on a conveyor belt. You know, you want somebody to buy an iPad, and then when a new iPad comes out a year later, you want them to buy that as well and somehow get away or throw away or sell or do something to get rid of the old one. Maybe even keep the old one. But as long as you're buying a new one, you're repurchasing. And this runs against the reliability of cars, because a car is so reliable now, they no longer drill holes in the doors to make sure they rust. It's the built-in obsolescence argument that goes back to Ford, when they used to go to the junkyards and check the old cars and see what didn't break. Cars really can last a decade now, quite comfortably. Mm. And they still fulfill their purpose, which is to transport our bodies, which aren't going to change anytime soon, from A to B. And I think it's a tough sell to get somebody to get rid of their old car and to get a new one. You have to use all of those surreptitious and quite slimy techniques.
Exactly. I mean, you're just talking yourself out of that upgrade path. But I'm not so sure whether or not you can draw an analogy with an iPad, because I think you can make a clear case that iPads generally do get better with each version that they bring out, whereas cars, it's still a freaking car. It's still
gonna, no, but it gets better.
It doesn't get better.
Of course it gets better. Better fuel efficiency, lower pollution, better safety features, better entertainment. An iPad gets better, but you can still read the news, you can still browse the internet on yesterday's iPad.
Yeah, no, I see where you're going, but I think, as I said earlier, we've sort of reached the zenith with cars. They're essentially trying to think about how they can sell you the same thing again. Whereas with an iPad, it's not. It's clearly an improved thing. But,
well, cars are improved things. New cars are improved. They really are, in lots of different and special ways.
Mm.
I agree that they still do their basic function.
Yes.
But there are always innovations in technology and better safety. For instance, a new upgrade, which I'm sure will be coming soon, will be self-driving cars. I can imagine the way in which the economy is going, people are going to need to drive to work much earlier to compete. And in order to do that, perhaps it would be wonderful if they could sleep in their car and their car took them to work.
Mm.
The technology has already been there, and it's been there for quite some time. But it's the public that needs to accept the possibility of having
driver-free
cars. I mean, you know, the Google cars that have been driving around Las Vegas for years only ever suffered one accident, and that was when a human was driving.
Mm-hmm.
So self-driving cars, new technologies like electric cars, and these will drive design because the technology will force new design. If you don't have an engine block in underneath the bonnet or in the back, and instead you've divided the engine block into four and you have an engine on top of each wheel, then where does the design go? You have to redesign things, and that those facts of technological change will drive new design. So who's to say what we'll think of the cars now in the future? And an excellent argument is that there are two schools of thought, and I'm definitely in your camp. When we look back at the original cars, not the original cars, but the early days of cars and the early innovators, when we look back and when we consider where we are now with car design, in the future, when we look back, will we look back to today's cars and think, wow, those are classic designs? Or will we always look farther and there really was a golden age of design and it has passed, never to be seen?
Well, I mean, I would think, we should sort of steer ourselves back on track with the car design. And what I'm going to say there is, I would think, no, we're not going to look at the cars that are being churned out now and see these as classic cars. But then again, I'm almost certainly completely wrong, because I was reading a car magazine, not a classic car magazine, just, you know, like What Car or something like that. And one of the motoring journalists was just waxing lyrical about some new BMW or something like that, describing it as pure beauty on wheels, using terms which I would have, as myself, would only reserve for cars, you know, luxury sports cars that were made in the 60s and 70s that do seem to have some indescribable charm to them. And he was using all these adjectives for some new BMW. But
why couldn't modern cars have indescribable charm?
Exactly. So I'm not the person to say, really. The fact is that it's perfectly likely that cars of today might become classic soon, but it's just I can't see it personally. I don't have that mindset.
It's as if there was only one manufacturer of cupcakes last year, and it was incredibly popular. This cupcake manufacturer was heralded as a baker extraordinaire genius. But now everybody has his recipe. There are a million variations, and the overall standards of cupcakes have just been brought up to the point where no further improvement is possible.
Right.
So then you think, well, have we lost something? And was there anything special about that original cupcake? The only thing that was special about it was that it was the first cupcake and that it was an innovator and it was original. But we have far better quality now and arguably more aesthetic potential now. But we don't have scarcity. We have plenty. And when you move into plenty, you lose uniqueness and the charm of original innovation.
I reject that for my own reasons. And what I will say about that and why I'm rejecting it is I think it's how cars are made now. It's the actual manufacturing process which robs them of any description that you could use for classic cars. Now, you would look at the Jaguar E-Type and say that's pretty horrible. And I'm with you on that. I look at the Jag E-Type and I don't particularly like the shape of it, and I don't like anything about it, really, but I can appreciate it and see it as a classic car and get why so many people look at it and think it's just such a beautiful design, beautiful shape and everything. And I think that's to do with the manufacturing. I think these days cars are made by computers and they're perfectly precise and all the rest of it.
Exactly what the designer intended.
Yes, whereas in the 1960s
it's just luck.
Well, there's a bit of that. There's certainly more craft. The cars are crafted by, you know, professionals, you know, real coach builders who have all these amazing skills.
What do you mean by craft again? I beg your pardon.
Well,
because the computer-designed automobiles now, could you say they're crafted? What is your criteria for craft? Time spent?
Let me just finish the point I was making. The point I was making was that in the 1960s, England was way ahead of the game. They were the number one car manufacturer. They knew more about cars, and they made the best cars in the world. And in the way, in a way, the Jaguar E-Type is sort of testament to that. And there's a lot of charm in that car for that reason, and a lot of history there. Whereas I would be surprised if there's any modern car that would evoke this that same emotional response from anyone ever. But I think I'm completely wrong with that.
Give it 50 years.
Even then, I'd be really surprised, because they don't have any of that sense of the numinescence. I can't think of a better way to describe it than that.
Well, again, my scarcity uniqueness argument is that there are far fewer cars back then. Car manufacturing was harder won, perhaps, in a lot of ways. A lot of luck could well have been involved. A lot of happenstance. And throughout history, when you look down the long funnel of history, you'll have a lot of episodes of this. So perhaps the Jaguar E-Type was, as it is, for reasons that can be repeated and will happen again, to another model. And maybe there are 50-year gaps between these events. It's not going to happen for every car. There are commodity cars, there are connoisseurs' cars, and there are freakishly amazing cars. The frequency of this may not be changing. It's just that the frequency is not what you might imagine it to be. And again, you're subjectively viewing a particular period of cars and a particular style of cars, when other people may well look at the Nissan Skyline and say, now that is a classic car. It's a classic design. And there are people who do this. Mm. They have the emotional feelings, and they completely appreciate the aesthetic, and they do believe that they're witnessing a classic moment, a golden age in car design with a modern car. I mean, when I look at the Bentley GT Continental, for instance, the one that all the football players are made to drive.
Yes.
I think there's something special about that car. I think it was sufficiently different from the other cars that were manufactured at the time when it came out. I think it has a lot of uniqueness, a lot of style, and a lot of aesthetic appeal. I think there was real vision behind it, and certainly a lot of passion that went into it. I would say that's a crafted car. And on top of that, there's the additional appeal for me with the actual the technology that's involved, the materials, the way in which the materials come together, you know, the actual quality of build, which of course is, you know, arguably much more accurate and refined than the classic cars of yore, which may have been put together by hand and shut lines that you could.
I would never.
You could probably drive a Bentley.
No, through. I would never dispute any of that. I'm interested that you use the word passion, though.
Yeah, I think it was passionately put together. Absolutely. I think the people who built that car are believers. Why? Because of the quality of the result. When I look at the Bentley Continental GT, I think the original one, I'm not too sure about the newer ones, I think an awful lot of thought, passion, vision, risk-taking, a lot went into it. Probably just as much as any other car. And
what makes it so special, then?
Well, because it works. You can have somebody who's immensely passionate about, you know, putting together the original Mini. I think it's a hideous piece of crap. But they were passionate about it. That doesn't imbue any positive attributes, necessarily. But the Bentley Continental GT just happens to put it all together so well, and it all works as a classic in some people's eyes. Again, the Tesla. You could argue that the Tesla, which is a fully plug-in electric sports car, a luxury sports car, it has the history, it has the uniqueness, the vision, the passion, on every level, just like the Jag E-Type, for instance. And again, you could look back at that, and there's a lot to wax lyrical about that in the future, I can imagine. Oh, well, the Tesla broke this mold, broke these records, had these problems during its production, culminated in this model, and, you know, like everything, you can get nerdy and look into the detail and find appeal and interest and aesthetic appreciation. So I think there's a vast amount of subjectivism that we just simply cannot discount when it comes to cars. There are rules in the appreciation of car design as well. There are certain design no-nos. There are certain conventions. I think it's like anything. When you have a huge variety and history of a thing, you'll get people who have strong opinions on that thing. You know, we could be talking about boats, we could be talking about aircraft.
But it seems to be cars that are real, I don't know, right in the center of people's faces in so many ways.
Well, yeah, we don't see many boats going down the high street. Although, having said that, there's Range Rovers.
No, but cars can say so much about the owner, and owners know that.
Can
is,
they?
Is my contention. Yes. Absolutely. If you're someone who wants to is your priority to spend ridiculous amount of money on this Range Rover Evoque, listener, if you want to go have a look at the photograph of the Range Rover Evoque in the show notes, that is a curious looking automobile.
Now I can imagine someone out there, maybe one person, might think it's beautiful.
Oh, I'm sure lots of people think it's beautiful.
I certainly see enough of them.
Yes. Are these actual cars? I mean, as in, are they on the road now? Is that a real thing?
Are you joking? They're all over the place.
Are they that?
Yes,
are you sure?
They are that. Okay. That is all over the place.
It looks like, you see now Range Rover as a manufacturer. I think they know their audience, I think. And I think anyone who isn't the type of person that has a 4x4 and who's driven on a normal road and have to deal with someone who behaves as though they own the damn road, the manufacturers of Range Rover know exactly how to please that person. And looking at this, the Range Rover Evoque, I can well imagine the type of driver that would have one of those.
Well, I think that's a little bit unfair.
I thought you'd say that.
Because the reason why is because I think it offers a lot there. For instance, it can offer lots of things to potentially very different people. Some buyers of that car may think they really want something that's small, but is off-roadable when they need it.
Is it
so? It's small and tough. Yeah, it's quite small. It's quite squat.
It's not small.
It is.
It's a 4x4. It's not small at all. It's huge.
It's not huge. It's okay. it's quite small. Honestly, it really is. It's not like the Land Rovers. The new Land Rovers are enormous.
Right.
This is dwarfed by a Land Rover.
It says Land Rover on the front of it. You sure that's the right
thing? No. There are different species of different varieties of Land Rovers. There's right. A Land Rover, which is really, you know, I have this car because I pull two horses Land Rover. And there's this sort of urban Land Rover, which could fit inside its larger brother. But I think people like small windows. I think people like not seeing the pillars.
There you go. That's a good example of that design. Again, listener, if you want to go look at the photographs and the various concept sketches, that what do you think that is? Is that the original concept for the 4x4 Mini?
Yes.
I mean, actually, BMW, who took the Mark, the Mini Mark, and made this new beast out of it, the new generation of Minis, I think are anything but. I think it's just bizarre. Not bizarre, but it's a real liberal interpretation of the Mini name to make a 4x4 vehicle.
Interestingly enough, well, this isn't a 4x4 Mini you're looking at, but it is a sports Mini.
Right.
So it has sort of like a half-height cockpit.
Right.
I've seen them on the road, and they look peculiar.
Right.
Really, really very odd. Mm. But there's a lot of love for the new Minis.
Yes,
so
indeed.
So you see a lot of them.
Mm.
And functionally speaking, if you compare them to the original Mini, I mean, there is no comparison.
There's no comparison.
So, you know, the family name and doing something to try and keep some sort of lineage, because a lot of people like history, and they want to have something to do with history.
Mm.
But they may not necessarily have the opportunity to actually buy history, or they may not have the desire to buy history. But if they can have something to do with it, then I think they're in. And that's part of the marketing. You know,
yeah.
Brand loyalty, model DNA, and cultivated market. But ultimately, we mustn't lose sight of the fact that people need to fit into these machines, and they need to be taken from A to B. So design is also functional design. They really do need to work. So they need to have indicator lights, They all have indicator lights by law. They need to have headlights. They have to have headlights by law. Well, they do. They have to have indicators by law.
Interestingly enough, doesn't look like an Austin.
So you have to design.
No, it doesn't look like an Austin Allegro.
No,
it does.
So design when you're designing an automobile, there are golden rules and there are requirements. You are required to design your car with a certain amount of external safety features. You are constrained by technologies in that you cannot make headlights that are microscopic because the technology isn't there yet. You are constrained, I think, by manufacturing a car that has glass windows because they have to be laminated. And if you have a layer of laminate in a windscreen, only glass is clear enough for you to get away with the visibility that you require. You have to have brakes. You have to have an engine to make it go.
Mm.
So your design wraps around all of these requirements and conventions.
Mm-hmm.
But even so, looking through all of the pictures in the show notes, I mean, there are radical differences in design. I mean, it's just an incredible plethora of design, and it continues, and risks are taken. The Nissan Juke, that is a pretty different looking automobile.
Yeah, I've seen a few of those being... they're the electric ones, right?
No.
Oh, okay.
They're a normal car, but they are very small. Right. Very small and compact, and they sort of look like a cooked chicken.
A little bit like the Bentley GT.
I would say it's turkey.
So would I.
And then you have the Chrysler 300, the American cars. Just a quick word on American car design. What is your general opinion?
Well, the Americans are probably who got the ball rolling, really, in terms of... making us care about what cars look like. Oh, that can't be true. Really.
It cannot be true. Surely no. The Italians started caring.
You'd think, but I think it was really the Americans who really had cars. I think normal people...
Yeah, and they bought European cars.
No, they did not. No. Normal people bought cars in America probably before the rest of the world did. That's just...
Yeah, I believe that.
That's just a guess. Yeah, but they didn't buy European cars. In the 1950s, Americans bought American cars.
No, what I meant by that is Americans who cared about designing cars bought European cars.
No, I don't think they did. I think European cars in the United States... I think Ferrari
always sold better in America than anywhere else.
Yeah, but when? Not in the 1950s.
Really? Yeah. I think we have to look that up. Perhaps we'll pop that in the show notes.
Perhaps. But yes, I've never been interested in the look of American cars. I mean, hugely influential. For example, British cars, when they started to lose their mind, they did see pressure from the American car manufacturers in certain aspects. There are lots of British cars that started to look like American cars but miniature, and I think that might have been the beginning of the end for this country being the giant.
So what of the future of car design? Where are we going?
As I say, I think we're there already.
We're in the future.
Yep.
And you don't think car design is going to change? We had a golden age of design in cars, and here on in, it's technology-driven design. Is that fair?
I don't think so. I think technology to a certain extent, a large extent possibly... But again, the whole small window argument, just the small window situation, I think, makes me think twice about whether or not technology really drives the look of a car. If surely experience has taught us that, as I said to you earlier in this discussion, that a car you can see out of is a safer car. That's just my contention. I know the counter-argument.
Yeah, there's a compromise. I mean, to a certain extent, if you have windows that are small to the point where you really cannot see out of them, then there's no safety benefit because you're going to hit that wall.
Yeah, but you've got so many sensors.
It's true. Mm. And, of course, there will be flying cars. There will be driverless cars, or self-driving cars, rather.
Yes.
We are going to see design that will be forced into the machines when they start leaving the road and into the air. Again, there'll be lots of constraints, but it'll be interesting to see what a classic flying car might look like.
I don't know if we'll ever have flying cars, actually.
surely.
I don't know. Well, who knows?
Every time you're stuck in traffic and you look above you, you think, wow, we could fit another 5,000 cars directly above me. We'd have no traffic ever.
Maybe.
The sheer volume of the atmosphere is mind-blowing.
Yeah.
And then, of course, we can get rid of roads, so the landscape would be much more attractive. We can get rid of agriculture as well. That'd be brilliant. Well, I think we've mostly covered everything. It's a tricky subject, I think. It is very subjective, and it's... cars are emotive, I think.
Yes.
There's no pun intended there whatsoever. But just to wrap up, I'd just like to mention that we do have a website, eclecticist.co.uk, where you can find the links to this podcast, our after-show discussion, the post-mortem, and also, of course, the links to our previous podcasts and all of the show notes, which we publish at the end of each production. The outro music of choice this episode is something open source, once again, so we don't get sued. It's called Faked Reality by Melodic Infusion. This is a three-piece band from the southwest of Germany. They write and play melodic punk for over, and they've been doing this for over 10 years. It's an attribution share-alike license, so as long as we credit them. It's very interesting, really quite fruity. They're very talented. Have a listen to that. Have a visit to our website, eclecticist.co.uk. And if you'd like to drop us any feedback at all, there's a form at the bottom of our webpage. Just pop in some ideas for shows or any sort of feedback or criticism. That'd be fantastic. We'll mention it on the show if it's worth mentioning. And thank you very much for listening. It's fine.